This special presentation was produced in high definition by WEDU, Tampa, St. Petersburg, Sarasota. This program was made possible by the Florida Humanities Council. We come from all over, and we become one state, where we share in the history and become part of the culture that is Florida. The Florida Humanities Council, bringing Floridians together by sharing the stories of our state. And by the National Endowment for the Humanities. The Frank E. Duckwall Foundation. The Saunders Foundation. And the Florida Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs.
Florida, a tropical paradise, a land of sunshine, a state of dreams. With nearly 1,200 miles of coastline, Florida is the southernmost outcropping of North America, the northernmost edge of the Caribbean. Here, all things seem possible. Wet is made dry, crooked rivers made straight, hot made cool. And the old are made young again.
Atta girl, see?
I just feel as though it's a new life for me. Because you work all your life, raise your family, and do all those things, and all of a sudden, you're old. So I came to Florida, and I dyed my hair blonde, and I bought a convertible. I did all that stuff, and the next thing you know, I was up on the trapeze.
Before the U.S. entered the Second World War, Florida was a remote and isolated state, the smallest in the South. With the Orange Blossom Special, a streamlined passenger train rolling south from New York, Florida was the end of the line. The bluegrass song inspired by the train is one of the most famous fiddle tunes ever written. Today, Florida is the fourth largest state with more than 18.5 million residents.
What does Florida do? Florida grows. And it's a growth machine.
But all is not perfect in this paradise. Traffic, overdevelopment, aging, immigration, and the environment are mounting concerns. During the last half of the 20th century, the story of modern Florida is one of astonishing growth. It's a wild ride no tourist theme park can match. These days, most Floridians live a short car ride from the coastline. But a little more than 100 years ago, nearly everyone lived a wagon's day ride from the Georgia and Alabama borders. Florida's rural population, sprinkled mostly between Pensacola and Jacksonville, numbered 500,000. Steeped in Southern culture, farmers in North Florida grew cotton and tobacco. Too wet and too distant, South Florida was virtually uninhabited.
When I was younger, the water seems to be very, very nice, clean water. Sometimes you feel like laying in a canoe, you just look down in the water, you can see a lot of little creatures, like the little turtles and the shrimp, snakes, under the water. You can see it down at the bottom.
During the 1920s, Florida's popularity began to grow.
Most of the residents, in fact, had come from the South, from Georgia, Alabama. There's a wonderful story. They asked the governor of Georgia in the 1920s. So many Georgians had moved to Florida, and they asked the governor what impact this was having. And he replied, "It will improve the IQs of both states."
A And then along came World War II.
PFC Thomas C. Wilcock, August 1st, 1943, Buckingham Gunnery School, Fort Myers, Florida. Dearest Pat, well, I finally got here, enjoying the sand and water on Fort Myers Beach.
Well, Florida was the smallest state in the South prior to World War II. Had 1.9 million people. The war brings in 2.2 million people. And suddenly, overnight, the population is larger than the population that had lived here, and they're from all over the country. And they're coming here to be trained for the war.
February is one of the coldest months in Ohio. So we enjoyed the sunshine and slow pace, and we were able to go into some of the people's yards that allowed us to pick the citrus fruit.
Around Florida's Big Bend, young recruits conquered the Wakulla River and the high dive at Wakulla Springs.
Under fire, they land. And at Amphibian Training Center in Florida, these are the latest tactics for invading from the sea.
At Camp Gordon Johnston, soldiers hit the beaches at Carabel and Dog Island in preparation for the invasion of Normandy.
Flaps are up. Gear is coming up.
World War II transformed Florida because of the role of the military. Wings over Florida soon became a familiar sight. Most residents could discern the noise and the profile of a P-38 Lightning or a P-51 Mustang.
From the backwoods to the beaches, Florida was home to 200 military installations. MacDill Field, Camp Blanding, Pensacola Naval Air Station, the Sop Choppy Bombing Range, Buckingham Field.
We did a lot of perspiring, and we broke out in prickly heat. They thought we had an epidemic of measles.
So where Florida had been a poor state, a small state, it suddenly became, thanks to the investment of the federal government, a fairly dynamic state with an infrastructure in place that could begin to accommodate quite a few people who were going to discover it during the war years.
I fell in love with Florida right there because, frankly, this boy from New Jersey had never seen such wonderful climate, sunshine. I love tangerines and oranges, and it was a great little village at Gainesville with a wonderful school. And I said, one day when it's right, I'm going to live in Florida.
The great change in Florida in World War II was that it was exposure. Millions and millions of servicemen, their wives, workers had come to Florida and had been so impressed with what they found.
They had images of Florida that had circulated in their papers, particularly during wintertime. This image of this beautiful landscape, the sun, the sea, the palm trees.
Florida, where you get school credit for learning to water ski.
It was like going to heaven. It was so wonderful. We were able to go swimming in the wintertime. It was just beautiful because there were so many trees and flowers. When up north, they were having snow.
Imagine you've spent your youth in Fargo, North Dakota, and you've come to Miami Beach for your basic training in the Army Air Corps. Your barracks is the Blackstone Hotel in Miami Beach in the Art Deco section. And they all pledged to return to Florida, and they would as transplants, as retirees, as tourists.
The war ended in 1945. When the GIs returned home, they were filled with dreams. They wanted to get married, get a job, go to school, buy a house, take a vacation. It was one of the most hopeful times in America's history. After the war, Florida was still very much the southern state it was before the war.
I remember as a kid going downtown Jacksonville And I used to love to go to Penny's and Woodworth and make coins. But I did, you know, the African-American family kind of keep you isolated. So I didn't know that I couldn't eat at a certain restaurant. I didn't know that it was a certain water fountain.
We're in segregation, apart. You over there and I'm over here. I got privileges you don't have. We're supposed to be in America, you know, free. But as far as black and white, that's what it was, black and white.
Under the Jim Crow laws, even the state's famous beaches were separate.
All blacks on that end, all whites down the other end. We never see them and they never see us. But it's the same water.
The laughter in their faces tells you that they're enjoying every moment of their dip in the blue waters of the warm Gulf of Mexico.
A gleaming white beach was one of Florida's most enduring symbols. And to Florida's misery, so was the mosquito.
Patrick Smith describes them in A Land Remembered, where the cattle would breathe in the mosquitoes and they would die. They would be suffocated by the cloud of mosquitoes that would gather around them. That's how bad the bugs were in the state of Florida.
To make Florida more livable, an all-out war was waged on insects. The weapon of choice, a powerful new wartime pesticide, DDT. On the matter of making Florida more inviting, there was all that water to the south. There's just too much of it, especially when it stormed.
Hideous, unrelenting, shrieking its rage, the vicious scourge of mankind, burying life and land under its relentless and merciless depths.
In 1948, Florida and the federal government came up with a comprehensive flood control plan. It was set into motion soon after the dedication of the Everglades National Park. The new federal designation was supposed to protect and preserve the fragile Everglades for future generations. Ironically, it didn't work out that way.
This is the story of such water and its mastery by the determined hand of man.
Over the next 30 years, the Army Corps of Engineers would drastically change the hydrology of South and Central Florida.
What they say, everything's going to be fine, and I think it's going to be better, and so here we are. That's what they say, but it's just the opposite.
Not only would canals and levees disrupt the natural flow of fresh water moving across the river of grass, it would open up much of the historic Everglades to agriculture and development.
The single greatest folly in Florida environmental history is unquestionably our relationship with the Everglades. It validates the ability of the Army Corps of Engineers to remake the wet Florida landscape.
Central and Southern Florida is no longer nature's fool, the stooge for the impractical jokes of the elements. But the work isn't finished. In fact, it's just really begun.
Just prior to the decades of growth that would come to define modern Florida, 1949 was a milestone. Along with the state's first sales tax, a new fence law forced ranchers to end a century-old tradition of free-roaming cattle on the Florida frontier.
What was happening by the late 40s, as tourists were pouring into the state, you had these horrific accidents, and tourists were getting killed. By the way, it was always your fault. You had to pay for someone's prized heifer. But the frontier ends the very same year as the space age begins.
On the Atlantic coast at Cape Canaveral, the Banana River Naval Air Station, an old World War II outpost, got a new name, the Joint Long Range Proving Grounds. In the summer of 1950, Cape Canaveral proved its worth. The historic launch of a captured German V-2 rocket propelled America into the front line of space. Much like the events at the Cape, Florida tourism was taking off too.
The attendants ring an underwater dinner bell at dinner time, and the porpoises demonstrate a really first-class boarding house reach.
It was an area that we knew we'd fall in love with, that we'd enjoy living. To have our family here was a a great dream, and it happened.
Florida's Silver Springs is to the south what Niagara Falls is to the east and Grand Canyon is to the west. A truly spectacular natural attraction.
The Florida vacation had arrived. Tourists drove down highways with magical names. The Dixie Highway, the Tamiami Trail, the Orange Blossom Trail. Along the way, the curious dawdled at reptile farms and jungle gardens. Among the many mom-and-pop attractions was the Cypress Knee Museum in Palmdale.
Electrically operated boats carry visitors through scenic canals at Cypress Gardens, and beautiful models in colorful gowns of the Old South are always available for picture-taking.
The exotic appeal of the Sunshine State and America's love affair with the automobile proved to be a perfect match.
From the mainland, a causeway stretches across sparkling Biscayne Bay to Cape Florida and to Crandon Beach. Certainly one of the most magnificent bathing beaches in the world.
Tourists came in the 1950s to really absorb the real Florida. They went, you could argue whether a golf course or a fabricated jungle gardens, but the theme was Florida, even if Florida was slightly improved. I like to say nature was enough. Sunken gardens didn't need anything besides some beautiful foliage and maybe a papaya punch prepared by Mrs. Turner.
In the wild, the real Florida was a masterpiece. Crystal clear springs were home to wondrous creatures big and small. Birds and alligators thrived in untouched rivers and swamps. From north to south, thick hammocks and marshy wetlands shared a seemingly endless landscape with panthers, palmettos, and pines. Along the inaccessible Panhandle coastline, beautiful sugar sand beaches and magnificent sand dunes lay undisturbed.
What we would not see around 1950 is a lot of people. The population in Florida was under 3 million.
The state was a peninsula of empty roads and highways.
As late as 1950, Florida was actually younger than the rest of America.
Although a paradise, Florida was about to get even better. Introduced in 1951, it was called the room air conditioner. The rattling metal box was expensive and slow to catch on, but climate control was here to stay. Florida was now the fastest growing state in America. 1,000 new residents a day crossed the state line. The rate was staggering and would continue through the end of the 20th century.
The Sawyers got the wanderlust when the ice and snow began to arrive back home, so they headed for a warmer place. This is their first visit to Florida.
Floridians, native Floridians, wanted growth almost at all cost. But Floridians, for the most part, hoped that this growth would bring prosperity.
While northern Florida remained true to its southern ways and rural lifestyle, on the lower end of the peninsula, sleepy old Florida was about to get a wake-up call. At the start of the 1950s, rural Brevard County barely had 20,000 residents. Over the next 20 years, the laid-back Brevard would become the fastest-growing county in the fastest-growing state. Home to Cape Canaveral, the Space Coast was one of the most famous places in America.
The programs at the Cape, which only a few years ago were science fiction, are today becoming science fact.
With so many scientists, technicians, and engineers, Titusville, Cocoa Beach, and Melbourne caught rocket fever.
3, 2, 1, 0.
But while the space age conveyed progress, Florida, like other southern states, was still stuck in the past.
I was overseas 2 years. Went over there in 43 and got back in 46. Everything we thought was gonna happen didn't. Like I said, we came back to the same Jim Crow. You couldn't do this, you couldn't do that, you know? And deep down, it really hurt.
The irony was Floridians and its leaders were as much responsible for undermining the racial heritage of the past they sought to preserve. And they did this because they were out there recruiting so many businesses from the North and trying to make the state enticing to both people who lived in the North and might reside here for part of the year, vacation here, or locate their business here.
I was one of the first African Americans elected to Congress in 129 years. That tells you something about the political climate of Florida.
I moved away from Tampa, Florida, to New York City to better myself and try to look out for my family. I send money back to Tampa and stayed almost 40 years.
The roads that led to racial change in Florida were part of a long journey. Along the way, African Americans showed their resentment towards segregation with violence, demonstrations, and the civil rights movement.
As those protests escalated, business leaders approached political leaders and said, "We can't put up with this. You're either going to have to address this in a way that resolves it, or we're going to move elsewhere."
During the 1950s, countless Florida dreams became reality. Most of the vacationers and transplants traveling south were white. They came for happiness and good health, sunshine and rejuvenation, and dignity in old age.
The Florida dream resonates a powerful message to Americans and the world. Come and live near saltwater, amid palm trees, and you will live a better life. At least you won't freeze in the winter.
For the man with the vision of tomorrow and the dream in his heart of living in the warm, sunny tropics, there is perhaps no more ideal community in America than the bustling seaside city of Pompano Beach, Florida.
Along with the hard-to-resist notion of owning a piece of paradise, Florida was attractive for another reason. It was affordable.
For example, these homes range in price from $8,000. Homes are designed for casualness, so you may wander with ease.
Florida was a dream state for the working class. 100 years from now, we'll look back, especially on the 1950s, even the decades from the 1950s to about 2000, as kind of a golden age for the working and the middle classes who migrated here. A retired mailman could move here from Chicago and live on the water. So Florida really was affordable. No one complained about property insurance or property taxes. This was an inexpensive state.
Florida was also a dream come true for savvy promoters.
We're coming around the Redfish Point area formerly. Now it is the Yacht Basin area of Cape Pearl.
Where some saw sand and swamp, others saw an instant city.
This was the first developed area. It grew from this corner here to about 15 miles north. It's unbelievable. I see it every day and I still don't believe it.
One of Florida's first post-war instant cities was Cape Coral. Eager customers swarmed model homes, then boarded small planes to pick out their home sites.
I took one look and I said, that's it.
This new city near Fort Myers was the inspiration of two brothers, Leonard and Julius Rosen.
Cape Coral has been planned as a hometown, free from the mistakes of yesterday.
In 1957, the Rosens, who made a fortune selling TVs in Baltimore, became two of Florida's most celebrated land salesmen.
Cape Coral, with more miles of waterways than Venice, Italy, has become a legendary way of life on Florida's Gulf Coast.
For $30 down and $30 a month, you could buy a subdivided lot, a ranch-style house, and the Florida dream.
They bulldozed everything over. They built three model homes. They brought in an aggressive commission sales force. They had Watts machines. They brought tourists to Cape Coral by airplane. They had tag team salesmen. They had listening devices and booths. If you forgot your checkbook to make your down payment, as an excuse not to put a down payment. They had blank checks from every bank in America, and Cape Coral was one of the great success stories. But there were so many more.
Florida was a gold mine.
It's come to be called the Miracle Strip of Northwest Florida.
Already established communities promoted reputations of their own. Daytona Beach, the world's most famous beach. Key West, the southernmost city. Pensacola, the city of five flags.
Big game fishing is a man's sport, but boy, what fun for a boy.
When it came to fishing, Florida was promoted as the best spot in the world. Quiet towns along the West Coast had their own appeal.
Here you can enjoy the winter sun as you relax on the green benches and frolic on the famous Gulf Beach.
Young couples liked what they found too, opportunity.
France and I were married in 48. In 1958, we came to Florida. In Tampa Bay was Sperry Microwave, and they offered me a job. That was a happy occasion because it's a dream for somebody from the cold north, believe me.
In the center of the state, the big attraction grew on trees. By the bushel or by the glass, oranges were synonymous with health and vitality. The best place to see Florida's famous groves was from atop the citrus tower in Claremont.
There are more than 17 million citrus trees in the 2,000 square mile area seen from the top of the tower, which is surrounded by orange groves, hills, and lakes for as far as the eye can see and beyond.
As an ambassador to the world, Florida orange juice was liquid sunshine.
Yes, sir. They really squeeze those oranges to get them into that little container.
East of the citrus tower, Orlando was the city beautiful. People came here for peace and quiet.
More than 50,000 visitors are attracted annually by the scenic beauty, perfect climate, and recreational variety which are to be found here.
But for vacationers looking for the ultimate Florida experience, there was only one place, Miami Beach. The architecture and lifestyle was glamorous, making it a favorite stop for celebrities. With the ocean breezes and the coconut palms, the atmosphere was tropical and relaxing. To many people, Miami Beach was Florida.
A new leader is on the scene, Fidel Castro.
But on January 1st, 1959, South Florida and the Miami of old changed forever.
For almost two centuries, Cubans had come to the U.S. and to Florida in particular to work, to study, to vacation. And so when the revolution came, when Castro's revolution came, Miami was the logical place to go.
The first to flee Fidel Castro's communist dictatorship, just 100 miles to the south, were upper and middle class Cubans, more than 200,000.
They had fled a very turbulent revolution. They hoped to one day return, and in the meantime, they wanted to find jobs, enroll their children in school, and have a peaceful existence until the day that they could return.
From the start, the federal government gave the exiles generous financial aid, stirring tensions in Miami's black community.
The huge Cuban labor supply has reduced job opportunities of Dade's 122,000 Negroes, 70% of whom are unskilled, 20% unemployed and seeking relief.
In the 60s, as the Cuban immigration escalated, the state, on its own and under pressure from the federal government, would begin to integrate its public schools, eliminate the segregation barriers that existed in all walks of life. Black citizens felt that finally the state was beginning to recognize the mistakes of its past, acknowledge its complicity in formalizing segregation. And so there was a sense of hope. But the state became caught up in the Cuban immigration, and its attention was diverted and focused on immigration of people from Cuba fleeing communism.
Statewide, there was an undercurrent of change. What was the new Florida going to be?
Freedom 7, oxygen is go.
In the 1960s, Florida was a state on the go. Cape Canaveral was the launch site for the first man in space. The Sunshine State even started to sound different.
In Hollywood, Florida, a neighbor's newly installed air conditioner rattled all night, and his neighbor took him to court, and the judge ruled you might as well get used to it.
Air conditioning was turning Florida into a year-round destination. The state's permanent population had doubled to nearly 5 million.
Florida was the place to come to.
Just as PR writers crafted perfect images to lure newcomers to the state, developers refashioned the landscape to accommodate them.
The symbol that best represents modern Florida, I would say, is the built environment.
Natural Florida gave way to houses, highways, motels, gas stations, and shopping centers. Even the state's submerged land was fair game. Dredges destroyed fragile marine habitats to create more waterfront property. Across the state, the use of DDT continued in areas still infested with mosquitoes. There was evidence the deadly pesticide not only killed Florida's insects, but also the birds and wildlife that ate them. Cars promoted urban sprawl. Power stations and manufacturing plants belched toxic emissions. Runoff polluted rivers and strangled Lake Apopka. Biscayne Bay and Tampa Bay were on the verge of death.
By the 1960s, there was hardly a body of water in Florida that was not polluted in some way.
More than 15,000 square miles of central and southern Florida flood control district are being studded by the mechanical restraints of man.
In the Everglades, the Army Corps of Engineers pressed on with its comprehensive plan to manage and control water. Work also started on a new project, the Kissimmee River.
And that means enlarging, controlling, and straightening this famous crooked river so that it can take the water smoothly all the way down to the big waters of Lake Okeechobee.
The Army Corps of Engineers and the state together were essentially creating a huge waste ditch for agricultural and ranch land runoff.
Flowing from Lake Kissimmee in Osceola County, the river and its wide floodplain functioned as the headwaters of the Everglades. The vast wilderness of central Florida still seemed a distant world away from the development consuming the state's coastlines. But not for long.
After taking a look at the land this morning, I say we are starting from scratch.
In 1965, word leaked that Walt Disney Productions had secretly purchased more than 24,000 acres near Orlando to build a new theme park.
This, the initial stage here, has to top what we have, or at least be the equivalent of what we have now in California.
I have made the appraisal that this is the most important day in the progress and the future development of this state.
The year before the big Disney news, travel writers voted the world-famous Cypress Gardens in nearby Winter Haven and the Grand Canyon as America's favorite tourist spots.
Word of Disney coming to Florida was certainly the most welcome news that the Florida attractions have ever heard.
In the meantime, vacationers from Alabama and Georgia flocked to the Gulf beaches around Panama City and Destin. But overall, Northwest Florida, home to the state's most impoverished counties, remained a rural oasis.
It's remained in its undeveloped state, mostly because of agriculture and because of farming and other things that have just allowed us to keep large open tracts of land and big beautiful oak trees and just undeveloped property.
In the tobacco farming town of Havana near Tallahassee, the pace was slow and easy. But 500 miles to the south in Little Havana, The Florida dream was taking on a whole new meaning.
What are conditions like in Cuba today?
Well, you know, I have a comment there. I can't answer that question.
With the freedom flights that began in 1965, Miami was welcoming as many as 1,500 Cuban exiles a week.
I remember growing up, every New Year's Eve, the annual toast was next year in Havana. Well, with every year that went by, it became very clear that we were going to stay in the United States and that we wouldn't be returning to Havana.
The second wave of Cuban immigration brought 300,000 more exiles to Miami.
They bought homes and paid taxes and saw their children grow up and get married, and their dream became the American dream. It became the dream that every immigrant has here in the United States. They became Cuban Americans.
While other states shared in the struggles of integration, only Florida dealt with the mass migration of a foreign culture. By 1970, Florida's spaceport had reached the moon and back. The sky was the limit. The state's population seemed to have no boundaries as well. Florida was prosperous and home to nearly 7 million people. In 1971, one word said it all: Disney.
Disney changes the dynamics. Disney was more popular than anyone could have imagined.
In that first year, an astounding 11 million visitors made their way to the Magic Kingdom. For Orlando, the quiet life was over.
110, 110,000, minus 110.
The new era of the mega theme park would ultimately doom hundreds of the state's old-fashioned attractions.
Walt Disney World diminished the importance of nature in the image of Florida. It diminished a sense of permanence in the Florida landscape. It turned the state into a giant theme park.
America's escape to the happiest place on earth transformed Central Florida with a torrent of development. Though he never lived to see his Florida dream fulfilled, Walt Disney's vision lives on.
And the important thing is that the Disney World is located just a few miles from the crossing point of Interstate 4 and Sunshine State Parkway. Florida's major highways carrying motors east and west and north and south to the center of the state.
Central Florida is a legacy of Disney World. There's no doubt about it.
The same year Disney opened, the Army Corps of Engineers finished its work on the new Kissimmee River. The winding 103-mile-long river was now a 56-mile-long ditch. Canal C-38 may have eased threats of flooding, but it also further altered the natural flow of water, nourishing and cleansing the Florida Everglades.
This water, you see, it's moving towards south every day. The water situation, it's not good. Water is bad because it's pollution. It mixed with all kinds of fertilizer. People use it for their growing different things like sugar cane and maybe orange grove.
But as successful as the state was in attracting new people, the selling of Florida was only getting started.
It was miserable living in a cold climate with the snow and ice and dealing with that every day and trying to drive. And it was dreary, cold, and you have a different outlook on life when the sun shines. And that's really the main reason for coming here. That's what makes it paradise.
Well, the springtime you've been waiting for never comes somehow. That's when you know you need it, and you know you need it. Now you need the sunshine and sea breeze, salt sand and palm trees of Florida.
There's a high anxiety in Florida after World War II, with all of what had occurred in the war evaporate, and Florida would be back to where it was in the Great Depression. And there was such concern about this that every single governor in the post-war years went north to try and entice people to come and enjoy the beauty of Florida, to think about moving here.
Come to Florida!
With a heavily wooded Northwest Florida rich in Southern culture but poor in economic opportunity, newcomers poured into South and Central Florida. They came from everywhere and for every reason under the sun.
After several vacations in Florida, we decided to retire and move to Florida in 1980.
Also in 1980, Miami's Cuban community grew even larger, with a third wave of migration arriving from the port of Mariel. Florida's population climbed to nearly 10 million.
And I swore I would never come back here. But like I say, I like the climate, you know. I like Florida.
And one of the reasons why the black population in Florida is now increasing is because the economy provides opportunity for all, including our black citizens, for the first time in a significant way in our history.
And we've been able to move Florida forward. But if you look at the educational gap, if you look at the employment gap, we're still not there yet.
Pushed and pulled by government, the civil rights movement, and the economy, Florida managed to redefine its southern past. A more diverse Florida was good for business.
6, 5, 4, we've gone for main engine start. We have main engine start. America's first space shuttle. And the shuttle has cleared the tower.
Condominiums transformed Florida's flat terrain into ranges of man-made mountains. Bulldozers cleared the way for gated communities and shopping malls.
They're only scraps of so-called virgin landscape that are left in Florida.
During the 1980s, the same kind of development that swept over South and Central Florida began to reshape the natural beachscape along the Panhandle. Seaside in Walton County was the notable exception. Built as an alternative to towering condos and concrete, the quaint and walkable beach town hearkened to another time, another place.
One of the great stories of modern Florida is how the state has been transformed as a kind of paradise for senior citizens. What had to happen to create a retiree's paradise was a number of factors. First and most obvious, people had to live longer. And the 20th century is a series of medical revolutions. Now one can reasonably expect to live till 85. But living longer did not necessarily mean people wanted to move from Duluth to Florida. You had to be sold on the idea that Florida is a special place. So it's rather improbable, by the way, that imagine that Americans would want to leave their family, their church, their ethnic groups behind and move to a retirement community in Florida. In fact, the word retirement community would have meant nothing in 1950. What's a retirement community? But in fact, it became a way of life, a symbol of modern Florida.
And there are times when we all need to feel young again.
It is perfect expression of a Florida dream.
Entering the final decade of the 20th century, the state's population soared past 12.5 million. Florida was the fourth largest state behind California, New York, and Texas. With revolution, political unrest, and new opportunities for commerce throughout Latin America, Miami was no longer exclusively a city of Cuban immigrants.
This is also an important place for people from Venezuela, from Colombia, from the Dominican Republic, from Nicaragua, from Jamaica and Haiti, from different parts. So it's not just Havana, USA anymore. It's a haven for people from all over.
Just 30 years earlier, Miami had been a resort town whose economy revolved around winter tourism. Now it was an international gateway.
billions of dollars circulate through the Port of Miami, through Miami International Airport. It has attracted investments from all over the world.
The decades after World War II have created a Florida that is much more multicultural, more religiously diverse, and more racially diverse than certainly the South and most of the United States.
Congratulations.
Immigration energizes Florida. Immigrants are, by their very nature, pioneers. They're the risk takers. People don't uproot themselves and migrate just on a whim. They do so because they have hopes and dreams, and because they feel that they can invest in a new area and make a living for themselves, but also make the area where they've settled better.
In 1992, the rescue of Florida's most critically ill ecosystem led to the creation of the Everglades Restoration Project.
The Everglades is now a completely controlled ecosystem that is subject to the whims of water engineers and bureaucrats. And as a consequence, we have also taken one of the most unique ecosystems in the world and reduced it to half of its original size.
The challenge? Restoring a semblance of the Everglades' natural flow. At stake, the source of South Florida's drinking water.
I believe that this earth, this place, could be safe, but only we want to save it. Don't destroy nature.
In 1992, a monster hurricane took aim on the Everglades and the densely populated South Florida. 200,000 people were left homeless. Andrew reawakened Floridians to the threat of living in the path of a powerful tropical storm.
We have solid motor jettison. All four solids came
out. At the end of a half century of unprecedented growth, Florida's population approached 16 million with no end in sight.
57 miles downrange and 7,500 miles an hour.
My father used to always say, well, you're halfway to heaven here. And he was right.
If you could have been circling with a satellite, Florida must have appeared red hot for most of the last 55 years.
Every hour, Florida loses another 20 acres to development.
It is good, and good for you.
In 1950, the Sunshine State attracted 5 million tourists a year. 50 years later, Florida tourism accounted for 72 million visitors. Supercharged by Disney, Central Florida's explosive growth was almost unimaginable. Had Metro Orlando been a nation state, its 2000 economy of $60 billion in goods and services would have ranked 86th in the world. At Claremont, winter freezes and development dramatically changed the view from the famed Citrus Tower. Hillsides once so fertile for oranges sprout a more lucrative crop, houses and urban sprawl. Florida ranch lands and agricultural fields face the same fate. Since Fidel Castro took power in 1959, 1 million exiles fled Cuba for the United States. The great majority remained in South Florida. When the city of Miami was chartered in 1896, the remote settlement had just 344 residents. Today, the population from Palm Beach County south to Miami is well over 5 million. On the Gulf Coast, Cape Coral, one of Florida's original instant cities, has the largest population south of Tampa.
We came here in 1981. It was about 33,000 population.
and now it's roughly 160,000.
Another instant city, Port St. Lucie, is the largest between Fort Lauderdale and Jacksonville. Following the lead of the Space Coast, Coral Springs, Pembroke Pines, and Palm Coast are among a growing number of new Florida communities singled out as the nation's fastest growing areas. The building boom has even found the original Florida, once the state's last frontier of undisturbed landscape. The Panhandle and Northwest Florida have been rediscovered.
Well, this area of North Florida is being rediscovered today because people are seeking to get out of the big cities. They've decided to take that step back in time in a lot of cases, and they're enjoying that.
Inspired by the architecture and new urbanism born at Seaside, a wave of communities has already hit the Panhandle coastline. Florida's largest private landowner, which controls 800,000 acres in Northwest Florida, dominates the projects. The young soldiers of World War II stormed the deserted beaches here not long ago. Throughout Florida, development and diversity has touched every corner of the state.
We are a diverse population, and everybody should be at the table. I tell people it's like the story of my grandmama's sweet potato pie. She make the best pie, but everybody should be able to get a slice of that pie because we all contribute to the ingredients of that pie through our tax dollars.
The increasing pressures of development have steadily taken a toll on Florida's natural habitat. More than 50 of the state's animal species live in endangered or threatened existence, the Florida panther among them. In the year 2000, federal and state governments finally approved a partnership for the Everglades Restoration Project. Still bogged down by funding, the $10 billion project is expected to take 30 years to complete. The task is directed by a familiar name, the Army Corps of Engineers.
We've got to plan for all of the people that's coming. Florida is still a beautiful place, and we've got to preserve it.
The Latino population of South Florida will continue to grow in the decades to come.
Florida's going to be even more multicultural. It's going to have more immigrants. It will be more religiously diverse.
The problem we face is that many people are willing to say the Florida economy is built on growth and let's keep it going. And at a certain point, growth is going to meet the environment and one of them is going to have to give.
The coastline of Florida is virtually built out now, and the population now is moving inward.
We face some staggering problems. Property insurance and property taxes may seem paramount, but I think in the long run, those are trivial compared to water. Half the state is water rich, half the state is water poor.
A test unique to Florida involves balancing the needs of a diverse population of young families with the demands of an increasing population of retirees. And when it comes to retirement, the future may have some new wrinkles.
And one of the great challenges to the Florida dream and to developers is, will baby boomers feel comfortable in the same senior setting in a retirement community? Or will they want to rock on in their individual lifestyles? No one quite knows the answer.
With the population now over 18.5 million, there are no easy answers in Florida. What happens here during the 21st century is likely a bellwether of everybody's future. During the past hour, Florida has grown by another 85 people.
You're supposed to do a jitterbug now that you got here.
But 40 other Floridians have moved away, disillusioned by rising property taxes, the threat of hurricanes, skyrocketing insurance rates, and growth.
The building around the area has almost tripled the number of people that were here 12 years ago. And as a result, the highway system and the water supply system is not up to par being able to continue living here. We hate to see what the future's going to be for us.
Since mid-20th century, millions of people have come to Florida to live and to play. They brought with them hopes for good health, happiness, and a second chance.
That's the show business. All right!
With millions of others on the way in the years to come, what will they find in their Florida dreams? Paradise or paradise lost?
Can we live together and address the environmental pressures we create? That answer is unresolved so far. But I think people see Florida as a symbol for everything that they've desired in life in terms of livability, that they're going to find a way to preserve it.
I think the Florida dream will be reinvented by new generations. To most of the world, this is still a land of opportunity, and there's something magical about Florida.
At a citrus packing plant, they sample the orange juice. And how is it these folks are able to seek the carefree life? Well, Mom has raised her family, and Pop just retired from his job. So there's no reason why they shouldn't do what they've been wanting to do for years. That is, enjoy some wintertime relaxation.
For more on this program, including additional interviews and teaching materials, please visit thefloridadream.org.
This program was made possible by the Florida Humanities Council. We come from all over, and we become one state, where we share in the history and become part of the culture that is Florida. The Florida Humanities Council, bringing Floridians together by sharing the stories of our state. And by the National Endowment for the Humanities. The Frank E. Duckwall Foundation. The Saunders Foundation. And the Florida Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs.
To order a DVD copy of The Florida Dream with bonus material for $19.99, call 1-800-354-9338 or log on to our website, thefloridadream.org.